I'm Dr. Saranath Kumar. So I'm going to talk about this session on data synthesis and assessing bias. Probably like from past sessions, from looking at this session, I'll be looking like an alien. But I hope to have few of the points what I intend to discuss here. I could reach you to the extent what I want to discuss. So looking at the life cycle of systematic review and meta-analysis, so we are in looking at the process where data analysis and results presentation. So we are in this segment. So I'm taking my sessions to the lead with the outline. So we are having that, like, I'm going to present the total idea of statistical aspect in following headings. So looking at, like, I'm going to bring up three case studies. So converting into like a leading, giving a lead to models and talk about heterogeneity and sensitivity analysis and then assessing bias. So these are the points I'm going to concentrate on in this presentation. So coming back to the case studies. So if you look at, these are the case studies which we worked, possibly your names would have familiarized by now. So first one by Dr. Rizwan. So the paper has been already talked about, like, efficacy of green tea based mouthwashes on dental plaque and gingival inflammation, a systematic review and meta-analysis. And the second one by Dr. P. Ganesh Kumar and myself, including in the analysis by looking at dengue infection in India, a systematic review and meta-analysis. And third one is Dr. Bhavani, which is, I'm going to call, the topic is about bloodlet levels and male reproductive hormones, a systematic review and meta-analysis. So these are the case studies I'm going to look into it and discuss about the statistical aspect of how things are worked out in each of the reviews. So the first one, if you look at the case study by Dr. Rizwan and Gope, the objective of the first case study is to look at efficacy of daily rinsing with green tea based mouthwashes in terms of plaque index and or gingival index as compared to other mouthwashes in plaque-induced gingivitis patients. So here, a total of 9 articles were included or considered for analysis. Out of 311 articles met the eligibility criteria. So the case study 2 objective looks like to estimate the disease burden of dengue fever in India. So here there are three objectives: to look at prevalence or proportion of laboratory confirmed dengue infection among clinically suspected, either in a hospital based, laboratory based study or a community based study. And second objective was to like zero prevalence of dengue in the general population. And third one was like case fatality ratio among laboratory confirmed dengue case, dengue patients. So here we considered 513 articles which met eligibility criteria. 233 were considered for analysis. So third one was by Dr. Bhavani and co. It looked at the objective of present study aimed to systematically review and synthesize. I just want to paste this what, however it is presented in the article. So it looks similar to like what is there in the article. So present study aimed to systematically review and synthesize quantitative evidence on association between occupational lead exposure and male reproductive hormones and sperm quality from the existing literature. So this is what the objective of the third citation which we have seen earlier. And out of the total 203 studies, so 23 studies were included or considered for analysis. So this is the first 3 point to clarify on what grounds the objectives were framed for the review. So now the second point, I have pasted the screenshot specially mentioned in the paper. This is nothing but the screenshot taken from the paper from each of the case studies. So like case study one, what is the analysis plan? So I just read out this, what is there mentioned. So the primary outcomes were PA and GA and the summary measure was calculated using random effects model and presented as standardized mean difference with 95% confidence interval for each index. Heterogeneity was tested using tau square and I square statistics. Analysis were performed using Revman. So you could see there are some underlined keywords which I have marked in red line. So probably I want you to concentrate on each of the underlined text. So this was a case study, the analysis plan. And case study two, this is analysis plan for case study two. I'll again read out this analysis plan. So we conducted quantitative synthesis to derive meta estimates of primary and secondary outcomes. So broadly, I'll give the highlight to wherever the lines reported. Okay. So for each study, the primary outcomes were summarized as proportion on the 95% confidence intervals were computed. We used log it and inverse log it transformations for variance stabilization. Mixed regression effect model was used to estimate the pooled proportion of dengue infections. Forest plots were used to display pooled estimates. Heterogeneity was used to heterogeneity was tested. Funnel plots were used. Agass test was used to evaluate publication bias. Independent variables potentially associated with prevalence was evaluated using meta regression models, sensitivity analysis, and R statistical program. So these are important keywords. So I want to you to concentrate on and from the second case study analysis plan. So from the third case study analysis plan, again, if you look at it, probably I'm not sure whether it is visible. So I just highlight what are the important underlying words. So mean and SD for all variables are pooled for PB exposed and PB non-exposed group to determine the pooled estimates. So again, the underlying point is like heterogeneity among studies were assessed through forest plots, Cochrane's Q-test, I-square statistics. Desimonian and lead random effects model was used to detect mean differences between the studies. And the third highlighted point is like meta-regression model. And fourth, next to meta-regression model is publication bias using funnel plot. And there is another terminology like contour enhanced funnel plot also been considered for publication bias. And next to funnel plot, we have sensitivity and subgroup analysis. And third one is to like looking at the like point is like we have analyzed the data using Stata software. So with all the three case studies and the analysis plan, I'm having a question, like, does it look like a common analysis plan for data synthesis? Probably I would give an answer, yes. Okay, so this is what like looking at, does it holds for all systematic reviews? The answer will be yes. So there is a common analysis plan for data synthesis. So I have briefly listed down that in this slide. So common template items for data synthesis. So this is what we have seen in all the three case studies. So one is effect size or summary measure in terms of systematic review, we call it as. And the second point is focused on, I have ordered this list of items. This is how step by step we proceed with the analysis. So we're going to consider this one as an order. Okay. So effect size or summary measure. The second point will be the pooled estimate. And third one will be the random effects model. Fourth one will be the forest plot. Fifth one will be the heterogeneity. Sixth stands subgroup analysis. And seventh stands meta regression model. And next to meta regression model, we have sensitivity analysis. And again, sensitivity analysis, we have publication bias, and which leads to funnel plot. So this is the common template which in for any meta-analysis is concerned, or data synthesis broadly I say, a data synthesis is concerned, this will be the complete picture of analysis you would think about. And it is not necessary that this you have any meta-analysis will have to have all these. So you have to, it may have, if you look at partial analysis, like it may stop with forest plot. Again, if you look at, we'll discuss with the next coming slides, okay? So this is a complete picture of any analysis plan you would think about for conducting data synthesis. So when you say effect size, so you have, I want you to recollect that, probably except the first point, remember all of the other points are like same. Effect size or summary measure is the one which is differing from each of the case studies. So if you look at the case study one, so again, the point of effect size or summary measure, it is refers to your objective of your systematic review. So depending upon your objective of systematic review, the effect size or summary measure will be used. So looking at the case study results one, so it is the review which talks about comparing the oral mouth, green tea based oral mouthwash versus other mouthwash, right? So the final output of any data synthesis will look like, this is the final output of any data synthesis. I use the word data synthesis. So this is case study one's results. We'll probably discuss about in upcoming slides. Okay. This is about case study two results. And this is about case study three results. Okay, so final end results of any data synthesis will be a plot which summarizes, it gives about details of all studies, and then a diamond symbol where we call this one as a pooled estimate. So this is what a final results of any data synthesis of a systematic review. So the idea here is, when you say data synthesis, the idea is to provide summary of all studies. That is what the idea behind conducting a data synthesis. So here is the logic I want you to concentrate on. So pooled estimate. So what is that? Here I have given a small scenario. So scenario one and two. If you look at, I consider as two groups, male and female, and their average heights were given in centimeters. In the scenario one, you could see the number of males and females, 50 in each. So total 100 and 50 males and 50 females. And their average height was given as 170 centimeters and 150 centimeters. So if I want to combine the estimates into one, it will be like a combined average. So if I say simple average, if I take average of 170 plus 150, the simple average will be 160. And weighted average, if I consider, weight is allocated to the number in each of the groups. So weighted average also same, 160. So scenario two, I have changed the scenario two now. There are 25 males and 75 females out of 100. So now the ratio has become 1:3. And I use the same average height in centimeters, so 170 and 150. So the logic here of using pooled estimate, now if you simply average 170 and 150, you will have the average of 160, but if you look at the weighted average, 155. So I want you to concentrate on this. What happens in the scenario one and scenario two? The simple average and weighted average does not change, whereas in scenario two, simple average and weighted average have a change. So the possible reason I would like to refer to is the distribution of males and females. So this is what the logic we were going to use, I want you to consider this one as for the models. So I take you to this one as models. So in this case, so here what I want to wish you to say is that when you have a difference, the point I want to stress here is there is no distribution. That is, in the scenario one, there is no change in the distribution of males and females, whereas in scenario two, you could see there is a difference in the distribution of males and females. That is how the estimate weighted average has been showing a difference, and that is what the point I want you to stress here. So that is how it will be related to the models here. So we mostly looked at, if you look at the models for in each of the case studies, they have mentioned random effects. By theory, you have two types of models, fixed effects model and random effects model. It relates to scenario one. So I want you to consider here this male and female as individual studies. And what you are going to come with pooled estimate is nothing but the weighted average. So the first point by theory says fixed effect model. I related to scenario one. You assume when you say the fixed means the studies conducted in all aspects, they are same. So that is what the theory by meaning of we say fixed effects model. And whereas we say the random effects model is related to scenario two, we say that the studies conducted in all aspects are different due to many other reasons. They are not the same. That is what the assumption behind these two models, and you could identify that. The estimates are established from random effects model because the fixed effects model no more have any reason to assume a fixed effect model for assuming every study conducted is similar in aspect, in every aspect. So that is not going to hold true. So that's where if you see, if you look at the analysis plan for obtaining the pooled estimate, so we'll be using random effects. So what will be the sum, what will be the weighted average here? The pooled will be the weighted average. What will be the weights here? So that is a logical question you have to think about in random effects model. So I highlight this with the upcoming slides. Okay, so what here, the basic logic is the difference is in the model is one stance assumes every study is conducted in similar aspect. The other one assumes the studies are conducted in, the study varies in aspect they were conducted. So that relates to the two different types of models. So is it fine to say, does everyone agree on simply pooling the estimates? Say I have identified a method now and I have conducted several studies and I'm just going to have come up with the pooled estimates. Simply saying I'm going to just pool average and say this is the estimates. Is it okay? Say it says no and it warrants investigation. So what kind of investigation is needed? So random effects model, you said it says like they are different in aspect. So one of the terminology we want to concentrate on is the heterogeneity. The heterogeneity word means to say that they are different in aspect. So first level, there are tools to identify heterogeneity. So the identifying heterogeneity tools we have here, I-square and I-square statistics, which is usually expressed in percentage. There is an alternative statistical test available to test for heterogeneity, which is Cochrane's Q. And further level of looking at heterogeneity will be the subgroup analysis and meta-regression analysis. So here, the subgroup analysis means to say like the overall analysis, we try to come up with identifying different subgroups and then perform the analysis by the subgroups. And meta-regression, again, this will be looking at each of the factors which will be trying to say, look at whether they are heterogeneous and all at one go. So we have some slides to talk about, show some demonstration on the, what are these are. Okay. So I have highlighted this case study one and three here. If you look at, I have underlined the results here. So one, it says p-value is 0.0001 and I-square 94%. The other study which is talked about lead levels, I-square it says it is 99.9 and p-value is significant for heterogeneity. So higher the I-square, it is usually represented in percentage. So higher the I-square, we say that the study you are trying to include or kind of trying to pool, the results are very, very, very much heterogeneous and you have to take care in coming up with the pooled estimates. That's what the message from these two slides. And we have identified now from these two studies, the first case study one and three are heterogeneous. So this is about the case study two. So like we are talking about subgroups. So so if you look at the case study results for dengue, so now the results were based on, we have presented the results by here. We identified that there are two subgroups here. Like we have divided the total studies into two groups. Like one is done in hospital-based studies, and the other one we have looked at in outbreak setting, whether the estimates get changed. So if you look at the analysis of pooled estimates, like it's not so visible, but I just highlight what are the estimates here. So like the estimates in the hospital-based studies, it is nearly 33%. And the studies which reported the outbreak or hospital-based studies during outbreak, we have nearly 47%. So it gives a clear picture that there is subgroups which there are heterogeneous estimates which are so to come up with the pooled estimates, we have to be careful. There are certain other heterogeneous factors playing into account. So one of the way we are identifying is through subgroup analysis. This is about meta-regression. So say for, again, this is for done for the dengue paper, dengue case study. So here, so if you ask, we have come up with the pooled estimate of looking at dengue prevalence in India was nearly around 40%. Does it same in, if you look at, consider region, say Northeast, if you look at, if I say somebody is go on to look at the prevalence of dengue in Northeast, it will be very low. It will not be 40%. So it is like, say, less than 10%. Probably now the exposure to dengue is increasing now. But so you have to look at as what are the, these are like whatever data abstraction you have done, we try to rule out or we come up with the estimates which are more reliable with the factors you have abstract with the data available from the papers and then which you are abstracted. So here we have looked at four factors. One is like region-specific analysis and then study type. We have taken this one into account. One is hospital-based, and then another one is outbreak. And then again, we have looked at case definition, whether they are dengue clinically suspected or WHO or NVBDCP definitions we have used. And also, we have considered year of study, whether year of publication done earlier stages, whether does it impact, have any heterogeneous impact on reporting. So when you want to look at several factors into account, so when we will consider a concept called meta-regression. So then comes still ask a question. So I have done several things, fine, but still my estimates are valid. Still my is it my estimates are valid? So if you look at this case, say for instance, the second piece of slide. Say I have taken consider prevalence of lab confirmed hospital-based studies during outbreak. So if you look at, there are part of studies which were like Chaturvedi or I remember Chakravarti. There is a report stating that most of the studies are reporting beyond 40% during outbreak, and there are certain one or two, three studies where reporting less than 20% dengue prevalence. So is it still to have come up with a pooling, combining everything into one and say 40%? Is it good? So that is what we talk about in sensitivity analysis. So even if I remove this, say the sensitivity analysis as it stands, so the idea is to remove sensitive studies which have lower effect, was carried out by leaving one study at a time in order, so that is what we do. So if you try to remove the major affecting study in pooling the results and see how the results are affected. So that is what we say by sensitivity analysis. And we have done this for dengue and have found to be like, even if we review much of the studies, the estimates were similar. So that's what this picture is talking about. So assessing bias. So till now, this is the complete picture when you try to talk about, like, when I say, try to synthesize data and come up with the pooled estimates. These are the effective points you have to consider when you want to try to do data synthesis. And again, I want to make a note here. It may not be all can be possible to be implemented in any studies. You have to have enough data to do that. So possibility of employing all may not be feasible. Okay. So this assessing bias. So what is bias? Here it is like again. So can it be quantified? So that is what here it's the challenges. Anything which any estimate from any research, we are asking qualitatively trying to quantify the, we are not trying to quantify the bias, qualitatively trying to go assess bias. So what do we have here to assess bias? We have certain tools for assessing bias. There are not only one. Here I have highlighted this one from the paper by this one, like this is for that plague study. So they have used Cochrane collaboration tool where it talks about bias assessment by seven categories. So random sequence generation, allocation concealment, blinding of participant. So that there is a seven category model for assessing bias, focusing on only RCTs. And finally, you come up with the risk of bias graph, whether to include like how each study is banned, what level of bias have been reported from each of the included studies. So I have highlighted only one tool. So here, probably the given citation will give you. I have listed this citation. I have taken this citation from where they have reported all possible tools. So this is 2015. So and again now till now they are upgrading the tools for how to handle bias. It's quite challenging, and which one is preferred over other, it is very difficult. So here, So I have listed only one tool. So probably if you go for that below reference, you could get all the list of tools for like, how do you summarize bias with say, for instance, clinical trials, observational studies, animal studies. So the reference gives a wide wide literature on what are the tools available for assessing bias. Okay, again, this one talks about the publication bias. Say, for instance, if you, even in this case, like if you have found out few of the studies which reported greenwash will be not working, so they have most likely chances that it may not get published. So here we have few statistical aspect of looking at publication bias. So here the terminologies comes like funnel plot, against regression, trim and fill, and cumulative meta-analysis. So this is how a funnel plot looks. This is applied for dengue systematic review. So where you could see that spread of studies were equal across each of the sites. And common softwares you could employ data synthesis is to like, we have here a review manager, which is free. Comprehensive meta-analysis we have to buy. R, which is free. Stata, which is we have to buy it. Excel, it is there, but you have to incorporate straightforward formulas. Also, there is a paper in BMC, you could see whether they have employed a meta-analysis using Excel. So finally, reporting guidelines are available, which they're going to talk. So one is PRISMA and other one is MOOS guidelines for reporting systematic meta-analysis results. So to summarize, data synthesis, broadly, I haven't used the name meta-analysis. So here, technical term for using data synthesis is a meta-analysis, the statistical method that combines the results of several independent studies. It is a process to come up with pooled estimates. So here you have forest plot, heterogeneity, subgroup analysis, meta-regression, and sensitivity analysis. This is the complete package you have to think about for looking at data synthesis. And for assessing bias, it is a critical appraisal of conduct of study in all aspects. So the process, it takes qualitative tools, and if you want statistical tools, like we have a funnel plot, Eggers regression, trim and fill. Okay, thank you.